I race for the competition.
You can go as fast as you want, but...
20 years ago, a lot of people killed racing. Today, very few people are even hurt.
Eyewitness Sports presents Chasing the Checkered Flag at Jennerstown Speedway, a preview of the 1991 Winston Racing Series.
Hi, welcome to Jennerstown Speedway and Chasing the Checkered Flag. I'm John Steigerwald. This is Bob Pompieni. Right now I'm speaking very conversationally. You can hear me, but it's going to get very loud here very soon.
That's right, 10,000 people and plus will be here this coming Saturday, April the 27th, 1 week from today. That's when Jennerstown Speedway will open and the official series will begin. And from next Saturday all the way to mid-September, you're going to see some of the best local drivers right here on this course.
And in the next half hour, we're going to show you why auto racing draws more people than any sport except baseball. We're also going to show you what kind of things you can expect to see here at Jennerstown.
First thing we want to do, however, is talk about the difference in cars that you will see here at Jennerstown.
Here we go!
There are four main divisions that race regularly at Jennerstown Speedway. The most prestigious and the track's headline event involves the late model series. These cars can be seen every weekend at Jennerstown. The drivers in this division accumulate points toward a regional or a national championship. There are 480 drivers in the Northeast region, and Western Pennsylvania has had three regional champs since 1987. A regional champion wins $25,000, and if he is lucky enough, a national champion will win about $70,000. These cars are V8s and average about 100 miles an hour and can reach a maximum speed of about 120 miles an hour. The next division is the Pro Stock division. These cars look a lot like the late models, but they have a restricted stock component in their V8 engines and can only reach speeds of a little over 100 miles an hour. Many drivers in this class are looking to use this as a way to get a ride in the late model car. Then we have the street stocks. These are American-manufactured mid-size sedans. Most of these cars are also V8s. Aside from safety modifications, these cars are very similar to a lot of the cars you will see driving down the street. The difference is they can reach speeds of around 100 miles an hour on the half-mile oval. And finally, we have the pure stock series. These cars are also only slightly modified from regular street cars. In fact, the only difference between the pure stock and the street stock are the tires. As you can see, the pure stock race on everyday street tires, and because of this, they are only able to reach speeds of about 85 to 90 miles an hour. While it might be relatively inexpensive to put a pure stock machine on this track, it'll cost you about $40,000 to put together a late model car, John.
And there will be plenty of special events here. We'll take a look at some of those cars right now here at Jennerstown this year. We have some dates for you. Don't worry about writing them down. We'll have them all for you at the end of the show.
Come on, stand up. Take those hats off your head. Get your programs and wave to the drivers of the NASCAR Busch Grand National Motor Tour.
Well, the first big event is Saturday, June 15th. That's when the Busch Grand National Tour stops at Jennerstown. These cars are either V8s or V6s. They can go up to 120 miles an hour. They'll run qualifying heat races followed by a 200-lap feature. Then on Saturday, July 6th, the oldest division in NASCAR, the Winston Modifieds, will be here. The Modifieds can get up to 135 miles an hour, and many of the top Winston Cup drivers are NASCAR Modified graduates.
Here we go, out of turn four. Keep your eyes on it.
The fastest cars show up at Jennerstown on September 13th and 14th. The International Super Modified Association will be part of the Fall Festival. These cars are the world's fastest short track machines. They get up to 140 miles an hour.
Down the backstretch, and it's the high-flying Canadian, Gary Morton. Here comes Seneca, Forbes on the inside. Right behind him comes Glenn Allen Jr., and we are racing.
the American Speed Association makes two stops here, first August 10th and 11th, and again in October. The August 11th feature will be televised nationally by TNN.
So now you know where we are, but maybe you don't know how to get here. So here's a map. Pretty simple. Just 10 miles east of Ligonier on Route 30. So now you know where we are, what's coming up, what kind of cars are going to be here. Next thing we're going to do is take a look at the drivers.
A Buy Pennsylvania First profile with power...
Look out! Look out! Look out! Oh, no! A bad crash in the front straight!
Now, before we go any further here, we want to say that you have seen some crashes, and you're going to see some more on this show. We want to make sure you know that none of these crashes resulted in any injury to any driver, any serious injury anyway, but that's not to say that these guys don't have that threat of serious injury hanging over their heads every time they come out here. And for these guys, it's only a hobby. They just come out here and do this stuff on weekends. Maybe a little bit more of a dangerous hobby than, say, I don't know, stamp collecting.
Try to get some temperature in the engine. Warm things up, show you people what all goes on inside the car.
Now you talk about having a weekend hobby that involves driving. This is what most guys think of. Nice, quiet day on the golf course.
Superb golf shot.
No birds chirping here. There's a little more at stake than a $5 Nassau. A guy can get hurt doing this. It's one thing to do this for the money, but not many of these guys can expect to make very much, so why do it?
Well, one time I really did think about it, I was up here at Jennerstown, and was in an accident, and there were four or five cars down on number three turn. I'm sitting there. My car had a flat tire. I thought the whole back end was torn off. The car wouldn't go. Two guys were fist fighting next to me. And I'm thinking, my God, you know, why didn't I take up golf? But I'm not a golfer, you know, I'm a racer. My goal would be to break even, because it's expensive. I'd like to make some money, and I think you can.
So there is some money to be made out here, but most guys have a day job, like Dave Wade. He's a plumber.
I race for the competition. I enjoy it, just to get out there and go fast. And it's fun, you know, but racing side by side with somebody, door handle, it's gonna get no better.
Most of us will probably have to take Dave's word for it on that. This sport may be for everybody to watch, but it's definitely not for everybody to do. I mean, a person could get hurt.
I feel pretty safe. I had a couple good wrecks a couple years ago, and I didn't really get hurt. I got bruised up. I got bruised from seatbelts, but I guess if you're going to get bruises, that's the way to get them.
And there's a fire under the hood.
But I feel safer out here than on the highway, because with some of these people on the highway.
I love you, Brett.
Well, maybe you have to be a little crazy to make a living or just kill some time by doing this, but then when you think about it, chasing cars around in a circle really isn't any crazier than chasing a little white ball around the countryside. Just a little louder, maybe. And speaking of drivers, Stan Lasky, who's the general manager here at Jennerstown now, was a driver here last year.
Yeah, but he had second thoughts, and he retired from the racing part of the business, although you get the feeling he might pull a George Foreman and come back. But until then, Stan Lasky certainly has a lot to occupy his mind. He oversees the daily operation here at Jennerstown.
My aspect from sitting in the office and doing this day in and day out is that we're in the entertainment business. So you come here to be entertained, much so like you would go to a football game, a basketball game, or anything else. The venue we use happens to be motorsports. It's very colorful. By its action and on-track and racing action and so forth, it's very exciting. So, yes, you're coming out to be entertained, and you're coming out to be excited and feel the excitement. And you look at these young fellows today coming up, trying to bridge their careers further and further, and you get to watch that from the ground up, I guess, so to speak.
Coming up next on Chasing the Checkered Flag here at Jennerstown Speedway, we'll take a look under the hood of one of these cars at a garage where the cars are built.
It's a 355 Pro Stock motor. It's a restricted type of motor with a two-barrel carburetor, and it makes about 340 horsepower.
Going to work for about 10-minute ride.
Pit lane here at Jennerstown Speedway. And you know, earlier in the program, John told you about some of the drivers who race here at Jennerstown. For most of them, it's a hobby, a way to spend a weekend. But for others, it's a total part of life. Take, for example, the Miller family. On the weekends, Rick does the driving, and Dave is his chief mechanic. And during the week, you can find them both in their garage, either fixing up cars from a bad weekend of racing or making a good car even better.
At the time, you can put 40 hours a week in them, 50 hours a week. It depending upon what happens to it during the week. If you don't really crash it all that much or tear it all up, it's not that bad. When you start crashing them, then the maintenance goes up on it drastically.
These guys do a lot of maintenance, and not all of it is on their own cars. Some of the drivers who race at Jennerstown race in the cars that were built by Rick and Dave Miller. For example, the gold number 2 car driven by Nick Comlin is the Pro Stock Series. It's a car that the Millers built.
We build the car around the driver to keep the driver very comfortable in the car. So the longer the races go, the driver doesn't get fatigued, his legs don't get cramped. And if his legs get cramped or his arms get tired, then he's not going to be able to go fast at the end of the race. And you don't go fast at the end of the race, you don't win races.
And while most drivers are devoting their weekends to winning races, these guys are devoting their lives to it. The money isn't great, but it's not all about profit.
You can make a living at it. It's not as compared to a lawyer or a doctor. It's not into that bracket, but it gives us a chance to do what we really like to do.
One thing the Millers don't like to do is to repair broken cars. If Rick has a bad weekend and he crashes one of his cars, they may spend long hours during the week trying to put the car back together. But of course, the bottom line is the driver's safety, and to make sure Rick is all right should an accident occur.
Well, the biggest thing is to see how bad the car is hurt if we can fix it and get it back out on the racetrack.
You get into a wreck and it's a pretty bad wreck, the first thing you think about is the car, the cost of what it's going to cost to fix the car again, because some of the prices of fixing the car can be outrageously high, and you end up losing sleep during the week because you'll do whatever it takes to get the car going again for the following week. So that means if you go a day or two without sleep, that's just what you have to do.
And that's basically the law of racing, I guess you can call it. You do whatever you have to do to win. You also do whatever you have to do to attract people to watch the races here.
Well, and they do a good job of it here because the people are coming out. Now, maybe you're not all that familiar with what's happening at racetracks around the area, especially here at Jennerstown. Maybe you think it's like the old days when the guys used to pull up on motorcycles with grease under their fingernails and come here and drink beer and be rowdy. Not at Jennerstown.
As far as the rowdiness with the fans, that I think that went out years ago. You know, at one time racing was in that vein, but not anymore. It's pretty well elevated itself to, especially this track. We try to keep it as a family atmosphere.
And you don't sell beer?
No, it's a non-alcoholic racetrack. We don't allow beer in the facility. We do not sell beer, and it's real conducive to family.
Now, was that a chance that you took by taking that stance, because you were, it may make the families happy, but on the other hand, these guys want to come out and have a few beers and watch a race. It hasn't hurt you.
We didn't feel that it was going to hurt us. Our opinion is if you can't sit through a race for 3 hours without having a beer, you probably don't belong here. And, we really don't have anybody that complains about the beer aspect.
So don't go away. Coming up in just a second, we're going to have a crash course from Bob Pompiani on driver safety, proper turn signals, that kind of stuff.
These bars are designed to protect the driver in case of a rollover.
Oh, no! We got a car upside down on the front straight!
The front of the car is designed to bend in a minor crash.
Oh, look out! No! Oh, no! A tremendous impact on Rob Hammond!
We're
we're getting ready to unleash this orchestra of horsepower. That green comes out and we are racing.
Not only gets loud down here on the track, things can get pretty confusing if you're sitting in the stands wondering what's going on out here, but there is a guy here who takes care of all that. His name is Mike Nelson. He sits right up there. He's the play-by-play guy.
Green's out and we're racing. Oh, we gotta make it 3 and 4 wide. Let's see, we're 2 by 2.
Most people know me, they know that when that green flag drops, I usually just say, we're racing. And they know that that's a trademark of mine. Green flag's out, and we are racing.
Here comes the lead battle down into turns 1 and 2. Oh, no! Look out! We continue green and racing. Oh, my, oh, my!
Now, what about your voice and keeping it from, keeping it, I guess?
4 wide out of 4!
You learn to take the enthusiasm and position it so that it doesn't completely wipe out your vocal cords. The one thing being, the race cars here will have a decibel rating level anywhere from 90 to 120 decibels on a front straight. So there's no PA system that can be above that that I can announce that someone could hear me clearly that wouldn't hurt their ears. So there's no use trying to strain over the car engines.
Kragan takes the checker.
Well, Mike Nelson's been calling races from up there for 4 years now, which means he's seen his share of wrecks here at Jennerstown.
But not as many as he did maybe 15 years ago, because 15 years ago, it seemed that many drivers were either seriously injured or perhaps even killed in racing-related accidents. But that's all changed, and now when there's a spectacular crash here at Jennerstown, many times a driver walks away uninjured. And that's because driver safety has become a big issue, and now unless there's a spectacular, violent crash, most of the drivers will be okay. Like this are not uncommon at Jennerstown Speedway. What is uncommon are drivers who are seriously injured, and this is no accident. Almost everything associated with racing is designed for safety. The cars are specially designed with the driver's safety in mind, and everything a driver wears is either crash-proof or flame-retardant. Rick Miller explains how the cars are now built for safety.
The front of the car is designed to bend in a minor crash. It's designed to bend to right to this point here, where it doesn't involve the suspension locations or the handling of the race car in any way.
Look out! No! Oh, no! A tremendous impact on Ron Campbell!
These bars are designed to protect the driver in case of a rollover, where the car would get upside down and slide down the track on its roof, so it doesn't collapse around the driver and injure his neck or his head.
The roll cage is held up very good.
This protects the driver in case he gets hit in the side in the door bar area. Hopefully it'll protect him good enough that he won't get seriously hurt if he's in a very, very bad crash.
Look out! Look out! Look out! Oh, no! A bad crash in the front straight!
20 years ago, a lot of people killed racing. Today, very few people are even hurt.
Today, with higher speeds and more G-forces, the drivers need even more protection. The seats and the steering wheel are padded. The seat belts are specially made to not only hold the driver in the car, but they also allow the driver to get out quickly. There is a fire extinguishing system on board, and besides the crash helmet, the driver's clothing is specially made too. There is flame retardant underwear, fireproof shoes, fireproof gloves, and a fireproof suit.
This will give you about 30 seconds of protection. In 30 seconds time, if there's a fire in the car, you should be out of the car in that period of time.
It is rare that a crash will be so severe that those 30 seconds will come into effect. It is in those situations that the drivers rely on the track marshals and corner crews.
It seems like when you're in a wreck, I mean, they're right there. And I know they've probably saved a few people from really getting hurt bad. I mean, they do a first-class job.
If I didn't have confidence in them, I wouldn't be out there.
For most of these drivers, there is danger, and they are aware of it. But they kind of put it in the backs of their minds, and one reason they are able to do that is safety of the sport.
If you want to enjoy the thrill of the competition and the excitement of motor racing, you know, there's a little element of danger in it. I know guys have had heart attacks playing golf.
Oh, look out on the front straight! The master on the front straight! Oh, no!
Now, we are not saying that these drivers never get hurt, because obviously danger is still a very real aspect to the sport of racing. But, John, in talking to some of the drivers that we talked to earlier, they said they could put the danger aspect in the back of their minds basically because of the safety involved now with the cars.
Right. A little earlier, we talked about the fact that there are plenty of special events coming up here at Jennerstown. Starts next Saturday with weekly racing. Next Saturday through September 14th, but a lot of special events, too, like June 15th, NASCAR Busch Grand National North Series. July 6th, the NASCAR Winston Modifieds. August 11th, ASA Late Models. Also August 31st, the 24th Annual Laurel Highlands. September 13th and 14th, the 3rd Annual Fall Festival. And October 26th and 27th, Oldsmobile 400 for the ASA Late Models. So that sets you up for what's coming up here at Jennerstown over the next few months. A lot of interesting things. We hope you've enjoyed the show. We're about done here.
Yeah, before we go, we wanted to share some of the sights and sounds of Jennerstown Speedway, and what better way to do so than through the eyes of our photographer, Richard Sutphin.
Who we stuck in a car with his camera, and you see these pictures, you know that he risked his life.
Yeah, he almost had his head taken off in the process, but he learned along the way.
I don't know if he got extra pay, but he should have. But that's it for us. We hope you enjoyed the show. Thanks for watching. Good night.
This has been Chasing the Checkered Flag at Jennerstown Speedway. And don't forget to watch Jennerstown's weekly highlight show, Chase to the Checkered, every Sunday at noon on KDKA TV2.